हेलो, अस्सलाम वालेकुम। माय नेम इज़ डॉक्टर फारूक जावेद। आई एम अ कंसल्टेंट न्यूरोसर्जन इन द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ न्यूरोसर्जरी जेपीएमसी। टुडे वी विल टॉक अबाउट ब्रेन ट्यूमर्स। बिफोर गोइंग टू द टॉपिक, आई वांट यू टू रिकॉल डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ द ब्रेन। वी जनरली डिवाइडेड इनटू राइट एंड लेफ्ट और सुप्राटेंटोरियल एंड इन्फ्राटेंटोरियल कंपोनेंट्स। सुप्राटेंटोरियल पार्ट ऑफ द ब्रेन कंटेन्स डिफरेंट लोब्स लाइक फ्रंटल, पैराइटल लोब, टेम्पोरल लोब, ऑक्सीपिटल लोब। एंड इन्फ्राटेंटोरियल part of the brain contains cerebellum, brainstem and cerebellopontine angle, that is CP angle. The normal functions of these parts of the brain are very important to remember, because whenever there is a lesion inside any of these parts of the brain, there will be distortion or abnormality of the normal functions of the brain. So first of all, we will start with the knowledge of normal functions of these parts of the brain. The frontal lobe, this is the area of the brain that is responsible for higher cognitive function, and as you know, we have a motor cortex here. So the motor component of the brain is part of the frontal lobe, and all the movements of the body are controlled from the frontal lobe only. And along with that, frontal lobe also controls problem solving, memory, language, motivation, judgment, different kind of social behaviors as well. Coming to the temporal lobe, it plays a very important role in emotions and smelling, tasting, hearing, different perceptions, and also the memory and different kinds of behaviors. Coming to the parietal lobe, we all know that the parietal lobe contains the sensory cortex, so the all kinds of sensations of the body are mainly controlled by the parietal lobe, like touch, smell, and taste. Similarly, we have also the hand-eye coordination component here, and we have a very specialized area of the brain that is called the Wernicke's area. It is also the part of the parietal lobe. We will discuss about the Wernicke's area in the coming slides. Occipital lobe, it is mainly responsible for the vision. So, talking about the language, so for language, we have two areas of the brain that are coordinated properly. We have the Broca's, and second we have the Wernicke's area. Wernicke's area is a specialized portion of the parietal lobe that recognizes and understands written and spoken languages. So any damage to this part of the brain can result in someone hearing speech but not understanding language. That means the sensory aphasia. So the hearing is mainly controlled by two parts. One is the primary auditory area that detects sounds that are transmitted from the air. So it is located in the sensory cortex. Second is the auditory association area, and it's part of the brain that is used to recognize the sounds as speech, music, or noise. So coming to the motor part of the speech, we have the Broca's area. It is a part of inferior frontal lobe. So what does the Broca's area do? The Broca's area can cause difficulty in speaking if there is any injury into the Broca's area. So the major function of the Broca's area is to make you speak actually. So the motor cortex is the part of the frontal lobe, as we already talked about it. So motor components of the whole body are controlled here. As you can see, the different parts are distributed in the motor cortex as given in this picture. So it is called the homunculus presentation of the different parts of the body on the motor cortex. Sensory cortex also has different parts of the body on it, and it is kind of similar to the motor strip or the motor cortex, but with very minor changes. Coming to the cerebellum. Cerebellum is connected to the brainstem and is center for body movement and balance. So now coming to the brain tumors, WHO divides brain tumors into different kinds of classifications on the basis of origin. So the tumors arising from the neural tissues they are called the tumors of the neuroepithelial tissues. Similarly, tumors arising from the meninges are called tumors of the meninges. So we can have also, can also have the craniospinal nerve tumors, hematopoietic neoplasms, germ cell tumors, ciliar tumors, and metastatic tumors. Now coming to the incidence of brain tumors. 1/3 of the brain tumors are usually metastatic, and the metastatic tumors are the most common brain tumors in adults. When we are talking about the primary brain tumors that are not coming from anywhere else, the gliomas are the most common brain tumors. And other types of brain tumors apart from metastases or the gliomas can be meningioma, schwannoma, Peutz tumors, spinal tumors, lymphomas. So in general, brain tumors usually present with the headache, seizures, neurological deficit, visual loss, personality changes, hearing problems. So all these are the presentation of the brain tumors. And when we take the history, we get different types of presentations. Like we can have the presentation of headache that is for the weeks, or that can be for the months. So on the basis of history and examination, we differentiate different types of brain tumors. So talking about the headache is a very important symptom of the brain lesion. So we will talk more about it. So how do we take the history of a headache patient? First of all, we talk about the onset of the headache. Then we talk about the different components of the headache, like what is the severity, what is the localization, and if there is any specific time of the headache, or if there is any recent change in the headache, or if there is any aggravating or relieving factor for that headache. And similarly, we talk about the association of the headache, if there is any vomiting associated with the headache, or any visual loss with the headache, or any other symptom that is related to that headache. The most important thing we talk about the headache in cases of brain tumors, that is the morning headache. Morning headache is the specific term we use for the headaches in the brain tumors. So whatever the lesion inside the brain, it will cause the increased cranial pressure, increased intracranial pressure. So there will be different signs and symptoms of the raised intracranial pressure. So there can be changes in the conscious level of the patient. There can be papilloedema in the eyes. There can be different posturing of the patient when he loses the consciousness. Then there can be decreased motor function. There on the history, patient can present with headache or seizures. Similarly, we can have a Cushing triad, that is a clinical picture in the intracranial pressure, when there is intracranial pressure raised. So what are the components of the Cushing triad? We can have the raised systolic blood pressure, low pulse, and altered respiratory pattern. Similarly, patient can present with multiple episodes of vomiting, and there can be changes in speech. And in cases of infants where these signs or symptoms are masked, we can find different findings like bulging fontanel, cranial suture separation, increased head circumference, high-pitched cry. So these are all the signs and symptoms of raised intracranial pressure that can be seen when there is a brain tumor. How do we diagnose? We go for the different types of investigation, and mainly the radiological investigation. Apart from history and examination, we go for the investigation. And the main investigations are CT scan, MRI, and in cases of meds, we go for the PET scan as well. And we can also have different laboratorial investigations to rule out any systemic or metastatic diseases. And then talking about the treatment varies according to the presentation of the patient, according to the type of the tumor, according to the condition of the patient. So before going to talk about all the brain tumors and their surgical treatment, I want you to I want to tell you that we generally take care of these brain tumor patients with preoperative steroids and anticonvulsant drugs, because generally whenever there is a lesion inside the brain, patients present with the seizures, and so we start with the anticonvulsant drugs. And similarly, when there is a lesion inside the brain, it causing the surrounding edema. So to decrease that edema and to decrease the symptoms of the patient, we use steroids preoperatively. But when there is a lymphoma, it can disappear when we use the steroids. So whenever there is a suspicion of lymphoma, we should get a preoperative scan before giving these steroids. So what are the different surgical treatment options for intracranial brain tumors? Starting from the very simpler one is that we can have the needle biopsy, and then we can have the surgery, and surgery can be of different types, like it can be a complete excision, it can be a subtotal excision, it can be just decompression, or it can be simple biopsy. So these two are the mainly surgical options. Then we can go for the radiation therapy, like whole brain radiation or the focus beam radiation or cyber knife or gamma knife stereotactic radiosurgery as well. And then we can also use the chemotherapy. So what are different common brain tumors? As I already mentioned, that the mets are the most common brain tumors and the gliomas are most common primary brain tumors. Then we can have meningiomas, vascular schwannomas, pituitarymomas, craniopharyngiomas, medulloblastomas, and so on. There are so many, there's a long list of these brain tumors. So talking about the adults, we can divide it into supratentorial brain tumors and infratentorial brain tumors. But as you can see, the mets are the most common brain tumors in adults, either in the cases of supratentorial lesions or infratentorial lesions. Then talking about the supratentorials, second most common is the gliomas that can further be divided into different types of gliomas. Talking about the infratentorial component, we have the hemangioblastoma as the second most common tumor in the infratentorial parts of an adult. Talking about the pediatric brain tumors, as you very well know that mets are very uncommon in the pediatric population. So the supratentorial commonest tumors are astrocytoma, PNET or the DNET cell or the DNET tumors, and similarly we can have the gangliogliomas. In the infratentorial parts of the brain, we can have pilocytic astrocytoma, PNET, that is the medulloblastoma, ependymoma, and brainstem astrocytoma. So talking about the midline crossing tumors, we also call them the butterfly tumors, and the glioblastoma is the midline crossing tumors that frequently crosses the midline by infiltrating the white matter tracts of the corpus callosum. In addition, necrosis can also look like a recurrent glioblastoma and sometimes can cross the midline. Meningioma, that is extraaxial tumor, that is outside the brain matter tumor, and it can also spread along the meninges to the contralateral side. So these are the commonest midline crossing tumors, but the butterfly glioma or the GBM is the commonest one. So talking about the calcifications can be seen on an x-ray or CT scan, but not on the MRI. So whenever there is a calcification inside the lesion, we should suspect these tumors on the basis of the location of the tumor. In the intraaxial, when there is an intraaxial tumor and there is a calcification, we can label astrocytomas 20%, oligodendrogliomas 80%. Mets can also have the calcification, ependymomas have 50% calcification. Similarly, we can have choroid plexus papillomas and gangliogliomas as well. Talking about the extraaxial tumors, meningiomas can have 25 to 30% calcifications. Craniopharyngiomas have almost 90% calcification. And apart from that, chordomas and chondrosarcomas can also have calcifications. So now talking about the ring enhancement. Ring enhancement can be seen on the MRI and the contrast films of the MRI. When we give the contrast to the patient and take an MRI, and if we find a ring enhancing lesion, we can have the following differentials. The most common one is the MEDS. Then we can have the glioblastoma, tuberculoma, abscess, infection diseases like toxoplasmosis and multiple sclerosis and chronic hematomas. So here you can see the ring enhancing lesions. So the commonest ones are the MEDS, GBM and the abscess. So now coming about the metastatic brain tumors, we have the very short history in this patient because they rapidly progressive onset of the symptoms are there. The patient can present within weeks or very few months of the brain tumor. So the most common sources of the metastatic brain tumors are lungs, breast, thyroid, renal, GI and prostate as well. How do we diagnose? We usually go for the radiological investigations. First to diagnose the brain lesion, and then we can differentiate it from the primary or the secondary brain tumors. And the secondary brain tumors are the MEDS. So whenever we suspect a brain tumor or the MEDS, we go for the MRI. The brain MEDS are usually presented at the gray-white matter junction, and they are usually associated with massive edema. So apart from the MRI of the brain, we usually go for the systemic workup to diagnose the primary site of the tumor. So we can have the CT scan of the chest and abdomen and pelvis. Similarly, we can have the mammography, bone scan, or we can also have the other diagnostic investigation as well to find the primary tumor that is causing MEDS in the brain. So these all can be the pictures of brain MEDS. We can have a single lesion or we can have multiple lesions inside the brain. So what is the treatment for the brain MEDS? For solitary lesion or less than 4 lesion, well, they are all of less than 3 cm. Usually we go for a biopsy if undiagnosed on the basis of radiological investigation. And then we can also go for the gamma knife. For tumors who are larger than 3 cm, usually we go for surgery followed by whole brain radiotherapy. And for those lesions, for more than 4 lesions, we usually take biopsy from any one of these lesions and then give the whole brain radiotherapy. But the prognosis in these patients is very poor, and the patient usually not survive more than 7 to 12 months. Now coming to the gliomas, as we already discussed, the gliomas are the most common brain tumors, and they usually present with the symptoms of headache, seizures, vomiting, and different other findings. The presentation of these symptoms can vary from few weeks to months or years as well, depending on the grade of the gliomas. When we talk about the physical findings depend on the location of the tumor. If we have a brain tumor that is glioma inside the frontal lobe, we can have the problems with the behavior of the patient, with the speech, with the motor component of the body. To diagnose, we go for the CT scan and MRI. Similarly, if we have a lesion in the parietal lobe, we can have the problem with the sensations and the coordinations and the judgment. So all these can be the problems when a lesion is inside the parietal lobe. So what is the treatment of gliomas? Gliomas are generally treated with the surgery. And we can also have the option of radiation and chemotherapy, depending on the grade of the glioma. Survival depends on the pathology and the grade. And if we have the pilocytic astrocytoma, that is grade 1, we usually go for resection. and with the maximum treatment of surgery and radiation, we can have a maximum survival of 8 to 10 years. In grade 2 anaplastic, endothelial proliferation can be seen on the histopathology, and the life expectancy is usually 2 years. In grade 3 or grade 4, in case of the new WHO classification, the GBM have a survival of about 11 months with the maximum treatment. Now coming to the meningioma. Meningiomas are the most common extraaxial tumors. What is an extraaxial tumor? Extraaxial tumor is that is outside the brain but inside the cranium. So these are the extracranial tumors. So meningiomas arises from the meninges of the brain. So on presentation, these meningiomas are usually seen in the female population, and they can have a duration of symptoms from months to years. So it's a slow growing tumors, and we can diagnose it on the basis of CT scan or MRI. On the CT scan, these can be seen the ISO2 hyperdense, and on the MRI it can be seen as hypointense on T1, hyperintense on T2, and very well enhancing lesions on contrast. So these all can be the presentations or the radiological presentation of the MRI of the meningiomas. So meningiomas are the extraaxial tumors that are coming from the meninges and compresses the brain. As you can see, all these lesions are coming from the meninges. So what can be the signs of extraaxial lesions on the MRI? We can have different findings on the MRI, like we have the broad dural base on the MRI. We can have a CSF cleft. Similarly, we can have a bony reaction in these tumors as well. There will be hyperostosis of the surrounding bone in these extraaxial lesions, especially the meningiomas. So what are the treatment options for meningiomas? The ideal treatment for meningiomas is gross total resection. But when we are unable to remove it completely, we can go for the post-operative radiotherapy as well. And the prognosis of the meningiomas, it can be cured with gross total resection with favorable prognosis. Now we talk about the different common CP angle tumors, and the CP angle means cerebellopontine angle. So here we have the schwannomas as the most common tumors, and then we can also have meningioma, epidermoid, arachnoid cyst, and other tumors as well. So talking about the vestibular schwannoma, it usually present with the hearing problem or the hearing loss. Similarly, it can present with the vertigo, headache, or the weakness of the facial nerve. Talking about the physical examination, all those symptoms can be physically examined and confirmed. Like we can also confirm the hearing loss, we can check the balance of the patient, we can check the facial weakness of the patient, and we diagnose it with the help of MRI. And in cases of hearing loss, we usually go for the audiometry as well. So that's all from my side. Thank you so much.